find me now, where your grace runs as deep as your scars. You pull me from the clay. You set me on a rock. You call me by your name and made my heart whole again. Lifted.
Here I stand, high in surrender. I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries out. Here I stand. My heart now and forever, my soul.
We back. Hey everybody, this is Gil Sotu. I'm the artist in resident at Makers Church. I am so excited to bring back Made to Make platform. We did some other workshops in the in-between, some great poetry workshops and whatnot, but now we're bringing back the open mic. So if you have talent, if you know someone who has talent, or you want to watch someone who has talent, or if you feel like you don't have any talent and you want to work on your craft, that's what platform's for. So if you're a singer, songwriter, dancer, whatever it is that you want to express yourself creatively within 5 minutes, come on out, register. It's all on Zoom, so you know that's the most socially distanced that you can be. It's October 25th from 6 to 7:30. I can't wait to see you there.
I know the tension of the now. I don't always understand. I don't always get to see everything. When I'm holding out my hand, becomes my triumph. is my song.
Hey Makers fam, happy Sunday. Thanks for joining us at our online gathering.
I'm Evie.
I'm Stella.
And we have a few announcements for you.
And our first announcement is on October 31st at the church and at our November 1st gathering in the park, we will be handing out care packages to all of the kids. We'll have more information later, but we wanted to make sure that you knew about it so you could pick one up like we are going to do.
We'd like to invite you to give to Makers. The ways to do so are on the screen, but you can text a dollar amount. Go to our website or the Church Center app. Thank you for your continued gifts to our community. Our next open mic night is next Sunday, October 25th at 6 p.m. Details to sign up are on our website and Church Center app. We hope you can join us.
And now a message from Pastor Marc.
Good morning, Makers Church. Pastor Marc here. I'm coming to you almost live. I'm filming this here on Sunday morning. And quick update for you. I had a sermon prepped and recorded that we were going to show today, and I'm running into some serious technical difficulties. Thankfully, we're in a series right now called Cannot Be Shaken. So we're not going to be shaken. And incredible good fortune, I had recorded a very similar sermon a few years back for another sermon series called Manifesto. And the sermon we're going to show today, it's very much the same essence, the same heart and soul of what I wanted to preach on today. So that's amazing that that lines up. And I still think it's really powerful. And I truly believe God's going to move. And so thank you for your grace. Thank you for your patience. I apologize for the bad quality. But once again, I'm very happy that this sermon is going to line up perfectly for what we're talking about as a church. And it's going to fit perfectly in with our Cannot Be Shaken series. So thank you. Let's enjoy and worship together. And yeah, love you. Talk to you soon.
And we're on the fourth week of this series. And one of the reasons why we chose this word manifesto, which is what we stand for, partly because it's M and we like alliteration, but also because the word is so much stronger than just a list of things that we believe in or a list of things that we think. A manifesto is the things that drive you forward. It's calls to action. It's truths about us as a community and a people. And we want to declare as we go through this series that we feel this is what God is calling us and leading us into in the world around us. These are the truths that we want to stick a flag into the ground on and move forward in truth. So we're in the week four of our manifesto series. We started off with the first of our topics, which is God is our maker. This idea that we are all created in the image of the living God. He created us to create. We are made to make because God himself is a creator, and that's a beautiful thing. And then we stepped into the week two, this idea that Jesus is our Messiah. He's the one who came to save us. He's the one who left the 99 for the one. He's also the one that showed us what it looks like to truly live. Scriptures say that Jesus was the author and the pioneer of our faith. He showed us what it meant to be fully alive, and he led the way forward as our Messiah. And then week three, we talked about the Holy Spirit and how all of this is only possible through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our means here at Makers Church. That is what drives us forward. It's what unites us together. It's what enlightens us. It's what empowers us. Without the Spirit, our church is going to fall flat every time. But with the Holy Spirit, scriptures say that nothing is impossible. And so we're stepping in now as we've gone through the Trinity of God's character, the Father, Son, and Spirit. Now we're moving into week four, which is about scriptures. It's about the Bible. And we say here at Makers Church that the scriptures is our manuscript. And again, manuscript has an M, so we like it. But also, we chose it because manuscript has this idea of intimacy. What the word actually means is a handwritten copy of something. It's not a copy. It's not a digital replication of something. There's an intimacy to the manuscript. There's a closeness, there's a proximity. And scriptures is God and humanity's handwritten note. There's such power and beauty and intimacy to it, and we're going to unpack that here together. So I'm excited to do that with you today. Thanks for being here. Sorry, it's fall now, so I'm wearing a long sleeve shirt, and it kind of keeps. Do you guys like fall? I feel like it's been kind of cloudy this week, which is controversial in San Diego, because some people are like, oh yeah, like hot cocoa and blankets and let's make a fire. And then the other half of San Diego was like, if you like clouds, like move, go away. And so I kind of like both, but I'm wearing a, hopefully it doesn't get too hot up here. But I'm excited as we're going to dive into this story, this concept of scriptures being our manuscript. And so I want to start with this idea, this passage in Luke. I'm actually going to read it right out of the Bible. Fancy that. And I feel like this story, for me, sums up what the scriptures are and what their purpose is better than any other story I could find. So we're going to go to the very end of the Gospel of Luke, and we're going to pick up here. This story takes place later in the day, on the day that Jesus rose from the grave and conquered death. And the story begins here. It says, that same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. And he asked them, what are you discussing so intently as you walk along? They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, you must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened in the last few days. The guy's getting a little snippy. He's like, really? You don't know what's going on? You're the only person who doesn't know what's happening. Jesus plays along. He's like, what things? The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth, they said. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and rulers and religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped that the Messiah was the one who would come to rescue Israel, and this all happened 3 days ago. Then some of the women from our group of followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said, his body is missing. And they had seen angels who told them that Jesus was alive. Some of our companions ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the woman has said. Side note, I love that scriptures is so detailed that it says that it was women who first learned the truth of Jesus rising from the grave. At this time, if you know the context, women's word meant nothing. It was inadmissible in court. So that detail that is written in here lovingly and purposely by the author is validating and affirming the truth and the power of this woman's story. And then it says this, and Jesus said to them, how foolish you are and slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all of the scriptures concerning himself. He takes them through the scriptures, starting at the very beginning. Moses, who wrote Genesis in the first 5 books, he starts there and he walks them through all the prophets about all the scriptures concerning himself. By this time, they were nearing Emmaus, and at the end of their journey, Jesus acted as if he was going on. He's like, well, all right, see you later. I'm going to keep going. And he's probably slowing his pace down to see what was going to happen. And they're like, no, stay with us. Stay the night with us since it's getting late. So Jesus went home with them, and as they sat down to eat, he took the bread and he blessed it. And then he broke it and gave it to them. We hear echoes of the Last Supper here. Then suddenly, maybe it was the way he blessed it, maybe it was the motion of him breaking the bread, maybe it was his Holy Spirit moving in this moment, but it says suddenly their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And in that instant, he disappeared. As soon as they see his Jesus, he's like, poof, he's gone, right? It'd be great if he like comes out of the other room, he's like, just kidding, I'm still here, but he was gone, he moved on. As soon as their eyes are open, in that instant, he disappears. And these two men, it says, they said to each other, didn't our hearts burn within us? Were not our hearts burning within us while they talked with us on the road and he opened the scriptures to us? Were not our hearts burning within us when the God of the universe opened up the scriptures and said, hey, the whole point of this book was to point to me. It is a compass pointing to the true north that is Jesus. I am the one to fulfill all of this. I am here to begin a relationship with you. And it's beautiful. I had a similar experience myself, not with the guy disappearing out of the room. That would have been awesome. But when I was 17, it was a weird season of life. And it was a summer between junior and senior year of high school. And it was just one of those weird, dark times where I felt this deep emptiness. This deep sense of having no purpose. And I really couldn't articulate why. You could call it a depression. I had no language for it. I had no cause or effect, but I felt it within my soul. And for whatever reason, I like to think it was the movement of the Spirit, but I picked up what was in our house, a family Bible. I don't know why. I didn't usually read that thing. It was just there. And I picked it up, and I started in the Gospel of Matthew. And I began to read these stories about this person, Jesus. And I could not put it down. He became so real to me. It was as if he was in the room next to me. I read these stories about him healing people and having meals with people who he shouldn't be with, right? The outcasts, the sinners, the people that society said no one should be with them. Jesus was going to them. He was subverting the powers that be. He was talking about justice and hope and mercy. He was doing crazy miracles and saying things that made no sense to me. But it stirred me in my soul, and I remember that sensation of my heart was burning within me as I read the story about this person of Jesus. And within 2 days, I had read all four of the Gospels, and I just kept going. And my life has not been the same since. I remember getting back to high school, and my other buddy James, who was like, me and him were like the two biggest screw-ups in school. We had like competition who could get the most attention. We were stupid knuckleheads. He had the similar experience, and we started a Bible study. And we would, like, at school, like, study the scriptures together. And they're like, oh, we can't just study the Bible. We have to put it into practice. And we, like, didn't know what to do. And we were, like, going downtown and feeding home. We didn't even know what to do. We had to be active. But there was this real, authentic passion that scriptures had awakened in me for this person of Jesus. And so in light of that, what I want to lay as a foundation before we continue on are three different truths, three different ways that we must see scriptures to really get the most out of it. First and foremost is this idea that Jesus is the prism or the lens by which we must approach scripture. If you were with us a few months ago, we did a whole series called Prism, where we talked about a prism, which is a thing that when white light hits it, it reveals and refracts all the different colors that had always been there before, but now you can see them. And it also can capture all of those colors and refocus them into a single beam of light. All of scriptures, as it says in Luke, is driving to this person of Jesus. It's this beginning, this invitation to journey with him. See, the scriptures themselves, they contain the truths of God. But the truth of God is a person named Jesus. Scriptures contain the words that God spoke, some of them, but the word of God is a person named Jesus. It says in 1 John that the word, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God, and the word became flesh, and the word dwelt among us. And everything that was made through the word, and nothing that was made without him. And it says the word is the light of life and the light of mankind. And that light shines in the darkness, and that darkness cannot overcome it. I love how in the Gospel of John, he sums up his whole writing when he says, you know what? There was a bunch of other stuff that Jesus did. And he says, if I were to write it all down, I suppose the entire world would be filled with books. See, this scripture, as powerful and as sacred as it is, and we're going to talk about that more, this does not contain everything. This is not God. This is an invitation to begin a relationship with the living and active person of Jesus. This is a starting point and a compass to guide us along the way. But God has spoken and God is still speaking through his Spirit now. So we must approach scriptures with Jesus as the prism, just like he said to them, you must see him in all the places. I love this too in John 5. He says this to the religious leaders. He says, you study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you will find eternal life. But these are the very scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me and live. You can study this book your entire life. You can learn every microcosm detail, but if it does not drive you to a real encounter with Jesus, it says in scriptures, we're just clanging cymbals, we're banging gongs, we're missing the point, and our souls will never fully come alive. We must see scriptures through the lens of Jesus. We must understand Jesus through the lens of scriptures. And I would also add this fact, that Jesus connects himself to his church. He says, you, my people, are now my body. You are my bride. In Ephesians, Paul says that when a man leaves his parents and goes to his wife, they will cleave together and the two shall become one. And then the next verse, he says, this is a mystery. But I'm not even talking about marriage. I'm talking about Jesus and his people. So when we talk about Jesus as a prism, we have to understand that Jesus' church, us, is a central theme to all of scripture. We must see it through that light. Second truth is we must read scriptures through the lens of the big picture story. In storytelling, it's called the meta-narrative. What is the overarching trajectory of scriptures? It's not just a bunch of random letters and notes and passages. It is leading somewhere. It's taking us somewhere on a journey. Scriptures is revealing a deeper truth of what God is doing in this universe. Starting from the very, very first words uttered all the way to the end, we see there's a trajectory. And it is defined by this reality that God is making all things new. He is guiding the universe towards justice and mercy and grace and faith, hope, and love, empowered by his Spirit, paid for by the blood of Jesus. And for whatever crazy reason, he chooses to use us, his people, as his mechanism for that. So we must see all of scripture through that lens. We can't miss the forest for the trees. In light of this, there's this thing called, it's nerdy, but it's called compounding meaning. Maybe I made up the word, I don't know. Compounding meaning is this idea that as you begin to learn more about something, the more it means to you. Let me say it like this. When you have a relationship with somebody and you first meet them, maybe you're texting and you get a weird text and you're like, I don't know, are they being sarcastic? Are they being funny? Are they being serious? Have you ever had that? Like you don't know how to read it. You get like a weird emoji to like your response or like a crazy gif. And you're like, I don't understand what this means because I don't know them. I don't have the context of their character yet. But as you begin to develop a relationship and you learn more about who they are, the next time you get, oh yeah, they're making a joke, it's hilarious. You understand because all these little interactions have led to a deeper meaning. That's all of scripture. All of these stories in isolation sometimes don't make sense. But in light of the big narrative of what God's doing in the universe, you begin to see truth within it. You begin to see the heart of Jesus even in these crazy obscure passages. It's like a film, like, I know I'm not gonna ruin this for anybody because it's an old movie, but Sixth Sense, if you've seen it, spoiler alert, Bruce Willis is dead the whole time. He's a ghost. Someone's like, whoa, I'm so sorry. But that's a crazy fact that you discover at the end of the film. And when you learn that truth, it changes everything. You rewatch it and you see every single scene differently. I've used this before, I'm a nerd, I love Harry Potter. There's a character called Snape. Severus Snape. He's like the second worst bad guy in the whole book, the whole movie. And you hate him the whole time. The very, very, very end, you discover he was good the entire time. Oh, dude, come on now. It's not spoilers. This is old. I'm so sorry. You can write letters to Shalice or Derek. I'm Marc, a pastor at Mosaic, if you would like to write a letter. It's mosaic.org is the email address, not Makers. But when you see that truth, and I love how J.K. Rowling, the author, knew that before she started the first book. She always wanted that to be the intent. You see everything differently. So when you see in the scriptures, Jesus saying, hey, these stories in the Old Testament about Jacob's ladder, about creation, about the serpent's head being smashed, and all these different allegories, he's like, that's me the whole time. I've been the Redeemer waiting, it says in scriptures, at the perfect time. Jesus entered the universe. He entered the world with flesh and blood and bones. We must see scriptures through that higher level narrative, that compounding meaning that only comes through relationship. I won't go through all of this, but in Colossians, it talks all about Jesus, about him being the image of the invisible God. And it talks about through him and by him, all things were made. He is the head of the body of the church. And it says this at the end, it says, "For in Jesus, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things." Another way of saying it is that to unify or to renew all things through himself, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Jesus and his purpose, we must see in everything. The last point I want to make before we dive deeper in is when you approach scriptures, this is for me, this is a personal thing I love to do. I ask two questions. I ask why and so what. Why did that person say that thing in that way to that person? Why did they use a poem versus a parable versus historical narrative? Why was it written to that person? Why did Jesus use Samaritans, who were these hated, vile people to the Jews so often in his stories, to stir things up with the people he was speaking to? Why? And then so what? What does it mean to me? What do I do with that? How does that affect the way I live? We can't just read these stories passively. We must say why and so what. We must wrestle with scriptures. I want to go through a few things now. I want to talk about a few things that scriptures is and isn't. First, there's a few of these I'm going to go through. Scriptures is not merely a list of to-dos or don'ts, a self-help manual, step-by-step roadmap, or an answer to all of life's questions. If you Google what is the Bible, you'll see a lot of that. It's a list of do's and don'ts, or maybe you were taught that. Oh, it's a roadmap. It tells you exactly how to handle every situation. That'd be nice, but it doesn't. And that's intentional. Again, why? Why and so what? What scriptures is, rather, is, again, it is an invitation to give a real relationship with the God of the universe. And less a detailed roadmap, it is a compass. And it is a guide, and it is a true north, and I like to say it is a declaration of identity. I don't think we always see scriptures as a declaration of our identity. From the very beginning chapter in Genesis, God starts out by telling us who we are before he ever says anything about what we should do or who we should become. He says, "You are my children created in my image. Male and female, he created them." And then God formed mankind and breathed his spirit and his life into us. He's declaring who we are. And all throughout scriptures, Jesus is trying to tell us, "You are my beloved. You are my children. You are my sons and daughters, my brothers, my sisters." And God is declaring who he is all the time. God is the God of the universe, the God of the heavens and the earth, the God of justice, the God of mercy, the God of grace. It says in John that God is love. Identity is all throughout scriptures before it ever gets into anything about how to modify your behavior in any way. We must understand that. Secondly, scriptures is not a word-for-word dictation from God. God did not speak and some scribe typed it all out word for word. It didn't just fall from heaven. You find this actually in a lot of other faith traditions and religions. God came and spoke to this one prophet and they wrote this one book that is now the Holy Scriptures. Or this person finds these gold things and they can interpret it and now they have this book. But the Holy Scriptures, the Bible, was written over 1,500 years by over 40 authors, 3 different continents, at least 3 languages. Most of them were murdered for what they wrote because it was controversial and subversive. It is God-breathed rather than dictated, and is full of humanity's responses to the divine. Listen to this in 2 Timothy. All of scripture is God-breathed. What that means there, the literal Greek says God breathed into the authors, and the authors breathed out the scriptures. To breathe is a double action. To breathe is an inhale and exhale process. God did not download verbatim into their heads. He said, "Your stories matter. Your lives and your contexts and your personalities and your heart, souls, and minds and strength matter. So I'm going to breathe into you, and you are going to respond with the Holy Scriptures that we have as an anchor for our souls. I love it's not dictated. It is God-breathed. It is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in all righteousness. It says here in 2 Timothy, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Why is it God-breathed? So that we may be equipped to do good work in the world around us. Not so we can be smart or have answers or become arrogant or in our knowledge to have the best theology. Knowledge puffs up, love builds up, and he says, I created you for work. Scriptures will help you with that. Because of that, we must understand that because it is God-breathed, every single passage is different. I love that there's four gospels. When I read through it in high school, I got a different flavor of Jesus through each one. So cool. So we must learn, too, that scriptures, because it has different authors and different genres written for different purposes, not all of it is meant to be taken literally. Some of it is poetry. But we say here, you must learn to read scriptures literally. You must learn to understand the context and the style, right? We've all seen people take things out of context. We've been taken out of context. We've stepped into situations where we don't know the context. And it's awkward, it's weird. We have that at my job all the time. We'll get into an email thread or whatever. I work as a fireman. I'm just kidding. That's Derek. Sometimes I get job envy because Derek's always like, yeah, at work, we're like putting out this 20-foot blaze fire. And I'm like, oh yeah, man, we were putting out fires at my job too. Like the servers were down. There was all these conflicts in the code. I work in the tech world. I'm like, oh, you know, and he's like, no, it was a real fire. You know, or like, oh, somebody, you know, the pump didn't work and the pump was broken. I'm like, yeah, dude, our Keurig didn't work today at the office. I had to walk to Starbucks. I feel your pain. I understand, right? Or like, oh, I hurt my back from carrying these children to safety. And I'm like, my wrists are a little sore from typing all day. But I don't want to compare. I love my job. I love what I do. I love being a nerd. We work hard and we have fun. But there's situations there where I'm included into a conversation, someone else's, and we don't know the context, and it all gets messed up. And we do that sometimes with scriptures. We're reading someone else's letter sometimes, or we take just one little verse and we don't read the whole scriptures. One thing that has been super impactful to me is I've begun to listen to scriptures as I drive through the Bible app. And I have a pretty long commute to work, and not too long ago, I listened to the entire book of Hebrews. I'm not saying this to sound cool. I did it while I was driving, and I listened to the whole book of Hebrews. And I'd read Hebrews many times in chunks. I was getting so many insights I had never pieced together before when I heard the whole thing. It was mind-blowing. Like, oh, I understand that the author is actually taking us somewhere. It's not just random chapters, just cherry-picking things. There's truth to it. Context matters. We must learn to understand that. Or we read something like Genesis and we get so caught up in the details of creation, right? Was it long earth, short days, whatever, whatever, evolution? It's a poem. It was never meant to be a scientific treatise. Whether it was God made man in an instant or God used evolutionary processes, what matters is that there is a loving God who intentionally crafted us in his image. We can't miss that. We've talked about here too, there's so many stories like that with Abraham and David or with Jonah, this prophet who was sent to go tell Nineveh, who the Jews hated. He was supposed to go tell them about God, and if they repented, God would spare them, and Jonah didn't want to go, and he gets swallowed by this fish or this whale, and we have debates, and how did he live in there for 3 days? It doesn't make any sense. The physics don't add up. And we miss the deeper truth that sometimes God calls us to go love the people we don't want to love. And we so desperately want to stay away from that. It says in there, Jonah says, I don't want to go. He's so honest. He said, God, I don't want to go because if I tell them about you, I know they're going to repent and you're going to save them. And I don't want them to be saved. And it's this revolutionary deep truth written 2,000 years ago that's so relevant to today. But we get caught up in the details. We have to read to learn it literally. It's so important. 3. Scriptures is not the only way that God spoke or that God speaks to us now. Nor is it an exhaustive description of God's characteristics. Rather, it is a testimony to the truth. It's beautiful and it's sacred. It is a collection of some of the encounters between God and humanity. I love how Martin Luther the Reformer says it. He says, God writes the gospel not in the Bible alone, but also on trees and in the flowers and the clouds and the stars. And in Romans, Paul says, creation itself declares the glory of God. Science is just a discovery of God, or the study of God's creation. So through science, through biology, through physics, through art, through poetry, we can learn about God through stories. I learn about God through stories. I love movies and books. I watch Game of Thrones and I see the gospel in it. I watch The Bachelor and I don't see the gospel in that one. That one's devoid of all good things. But even just a few days ago, my wife and I were watching one of those chef shows. I think it was Top Chef. I don't know what it was, but it was on Netflix. And it was going through in the South, there's this fusion of Vietnamese food and Southern Cajun food. Because after the war, in the late 70s and early 80s, a bunch of Vietnamese were brought in as refugees. And at first, there was a bunch of conflict when they came into Houston. People were, they're taking our jobs. And now there's actually been a really beautiful community that's formed. And they sat down with this one chef at this little hole-in-the-wall place. And the food looked incredible. The colors, and you could almost like smell it and taste it through the TV. And the chefs who were eating, they said, this is mind-blowing. They said, you know you could be charging 5 times what you charge for this food. And I expected them to say, like, oh, I didn't know that. I'm gonna go start another restaurant. But this old Vietnamese immigrant who now calls himself an American says, yeah, I know. I know I could charge more. But this food is a thank you to this community that has embraced me. This food is my gift to say thank you and to say, you're American, I'm American, and I want to love you. And I thought, man, even in this cooking show, I see the gospel presented. God speaks all the time. It's like the road to Emmaus. Jesus was walking alongside of them for probably hours explaining this, and they didn't even recognize him yet. Is God walking alongside of you, speaking to you through whatever means necessary to get to your heart, and you're not aware of it yet? But God says, if you seek, you will find. If you ask, it will be given to you. Ask for an encounter with Jesus. Ask for him through his Spirit to reveal truth. And I believe that he will reveal that to us. 4, Scriptures is not safe, boring, archaic, or obsolete. It is progressive. It is enlightened. It is authoritative. It is relevant, boundary-pushing, subversive, raw, honest, surprising, dangerous, compelling. Again, there's a reason most of the authors were killed. The prophets of old and the gospel writers, because they called out the hypocrisy and the greed and the corruption they saw around them. Again, it's also authoritative, which is challenging for us, because so often we want to pick and choose scriptures we like. We like to read our own views into scriptures rather than let scriptures teach us a better understanding of God. And Augustine, the early church father, said this: if you believe what you like in the gospel and reject what you don't like, it is not the gospel you believe, but yourself. I don't know about you, but I want something bigger than just myself. I want a truth deeper than I am able to. I want Jesus, I want the God of the universe to fully understand that we need scriptures. 5, Scriptures is not meant to limit us, it's meant to liberate us. Some boundaries are good. Boundaries in life are not a bad thing. It's good to focus us on what's best. But sometimes scriptures have been used as a weapon to belittle people, to shame people, to control people. Scriptures was never meant to be used. The Bible was never meant to be used to hurt you. And if you've been hurt by verses taken out of context or misabused by someone trying to gain power or to seem smart, I'm deeply sorry for that. Scriptures was never meant to limit you, but to liberate you. And I want to begin to close this sermon with this idea. I want to wrap up with this thought. These are just my own crazy ideas. It's called the medium is the message. If you ever took a communication class in college, you probably heard that phrase, the medium is the message. What that means is sometimes the way a message is communicated is just as important as what is said. For example, texting someone is different than giving them a phone call, which who calls anymore? That's weird. It's for old people. Or an email, or a written letter, or sliding into somebody's DM, right, on Instagram. They're all different. If I text my wife, I love you, and I handwrite her a note that says I love you, they're going to mean different things. Same exact words. The method, the transmission method, is where all the meaning comes from. So again, if we're asking why and so what, why did God not just download scriptures to us? Why did he choose to use us broken, messy, fallible people to craft a response, to breathe back a response that is scriptures? Again, we must ask why and so what, because he didn't have to do it that way. And the best explanation in my head at this season of my life is I think about my nephew Logan. He's about to turn 11 in a few days. Amazing, phenomenal, sweet kid. He's on the spectrum. He's high functioning, but he's on the spectrum. The sweetest, most empathetic kid. He's always looking out for his younger brother and sister. Always, always encouraging kids at school. But he has a really bad speech impediment. And he knows, he's always telling my brother, like, Dad, why am I the dumbest kid in class? And it breaks my heart to see him. He feels the weight of being slower than everyone else. And I see my brother interact with him, and I notice my brother a lot of times will have him do things. For example, if someone comes to the door delivering a package, my brother will send Logan, hey, go get that and go sign for me. There's a good chance Logan's gonna mess that whole situation up. Or I've seen him at restaurants where he's like, hey, Logan, can you take this, go pay the bill and make sure to give him a tip. And, you know, he's doing these situations where Logan has the ability to somehow screw it up. Or I was there a few months ago and we were building a bunk bed and my brother was asking Logan, hey, how should we build this? What do you think? He was asking for his input, right? Why? Because he's trying to build up Logan's confidence. He's trying to reveal to Logan that he has value and worth and that there's purpose for him. He's gonna be a man one day and there is purpose for his life. He tells him, Logan, you're gonna do big things one day. And he has to prepare him along the way in that process. So I wonder if God did it because he said, hey, the scriptures, you're not just a damsel in distress. You are my people who I'm raising up to be about my business of reconciliation and renewal. And I'm gonna involve you in this because I'm teaching you something. And the risk is, man, if we're being really honest, over the thousands of years of people transcribing by hand, sometimes little things get messed up. Sometimes little scraps of paper get lost. Sometimes there's verses or chapters that we're not sure about. But that does not make it any less powerful or true or beautiful. In fact, it makes it more beautiful. I think about Beatles albums on vinyl. I was raised on the Beatles. My biological dad growing up before he passed loved the Beatles, and I inherited all of his records. And man, I put those things on, and it stirs me, but it's full of pops and buzzes and Ringo's drum beats getting behind, and George pushes the rhythm, and John's vocals are a little out of tune. But I wouldn't change a thing about it, because it doesn't need to be perfect to be good or to be beautiful. And to me, these scriptures are absolutely beautiful and authoritative. And it is God and humanity as a father with a child, this process of breathing back and forth, having this encounter, this relationship. This book is a product of a relationship and is meant to bring about relationship in us. We can't miss this. As I close, really quick, super quick, some tips for us. Practical tips as you engage with scriptures. Going through them fast. Remember the prisms of Jesus, church, and the meta-narrative. Keep those in mind as you interpret scriptures. Don't forget to ask why and so what. Learn as much as you can to read scriptures literally. But you know what? We're a body. So there's gonna be nerds like me who love to research this stuff, and I can tell you about it if you don't wanna study it. So just get the knowledge and the insight somehow. Interpret the lesser known in light of the more known or the stronger truth. Sometimes we come across these weird, obscure passages. Interpret that with the deeper truths you know. For example, the only time that God is declared so strongly as something is when he says God is love. So that is a stronger truth than anything else you find in scriptures. Keep that in mind. True understanding of scriptures only comes by living it out. You can't just hear it, you gotta do it. Scriptures can only be fully understood within the context of community. We're meant to hear it together, process it together, wrestle with it together. We must approach scriptures with respect and humility and honor those that came before us. Who are we to think we know more than thousands of years of generations of people following Jesus? We must build upon that story that God is leading us into. And finally, don't lose your curiosity. Don't stop wrestling with scriptures. God is not afraid of your doubts or your questions. Just like in a relationship, It falls apart not when you wrestle or have conflict, but when you give up. And whether you give up by just no longer engaging with it, or whether you give up by thinking you have it all figured out, which in both situations, it's a loss of curiosity, your spirituality will atrophy. Don't stop wrestling. And then the last thing is, how do you know if you're headed in the right direction when you're reading scriptures? I say this all the time, freedom and fruit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And Jesus says, you will know them by their fruit. Are you experiencing freedom in your life? Freedom from addictions, from pride, from arrogance, from dark thinking? Or are you experiencing fruit? Are you becoming more creative, more loving, more empathetic, more inquisitive, full of more joy, peace, patience, kindness, love, goodness? If not, maybe there's something broken in either your understanding of scriptures or your application of it. But if you are growing in freedom and fruit, man, something's working in your understanding and your application of scriptures. And I pray as we engage with this, I pray that we do engage with it. I pray that I engage with scriptures more, because I want my heart to always be burning within me, seeing at all point back to Jesus. I want my heart to burn within me when I read scriptures again. I cannot put into words how my life was changed when I was 17 from reading the stories of this person. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the gift of scriptures, that you would choose to speak to us and speak with us and speak through us. It is a mystery, as it says in Ephesians. It is a mystery. But God, I know it's because you have a purpose beyond what we can even understand sometimes. But I know your purposes are good and your promises are true. And you have jobs for us to do as your children. We were made to make, created to create. And that only happens when we follow your Son and when we're empowered by your Holy Spirit. And we learn to milk these scriptures for all that they're worth. We honor you, Jesus, the Word of God. In your holy, precious name, amen.
Hey, Makers Church, Pastor Derek here. I hope that you enjoyed this morning. Hey, I have a really exciting update. It has been 7 months since most of us have seen each other at a church gathering, and we have our first gathering together coming up on November 1st. It's going to be Church in the Park at Morley Field at 9 a.m. It's over by the baseball diamonds. Plenty of parking, bathrooms. It is going to be a safe, socially distant, sanitized, and really, really special Sunday morning. We cannot wait to gather with you, to worship with you, with our live worship team. I'll be preaching live, and we just cannot wait to see your smiling faces. It's a bring your own kind of everything event. Bring your own blanket, chair, umbrella, bring a picnic if you wanna stay for a while after. And we just can't wait to gather, to worship with you, and to see each other's faces. Now, we will still be doing church online. And so if you are not ready to come to something in person, we will be serving you well with our church online experience. And we totally love and support you in making that decision. But for those of you that are ready to come out and enjoy some time together in a socially distant, safe way, it is gonna happen November 1st, 9 a.m. We cannot wait to see you there. Now, the most important thing is that you register to come. And you can find the registration by going to makerschurch.org/events. We need to know you're coming so that we can provide enough safe place and have enough stuff to go around. So we want to know that you're coming. Please register as soon as you possibly can. And we'll see you November 1st. God bless.